Welcome back, everyone, to another episode of Conversations with Jeff Bucknam. I'm your ever-enthusiastic host, Tommy Kreitz, and joining me, as always, is the man who puts the doc in doctorate, Dr. Jeff Bucknam. Jeff, how are we doing today?
Well, Tommy, I was doing great until you reminded me I still have to pay off those student loans. But other than that, life is good.
Hey, at least you can say Dr. Bucknam, and people don't just assume you're the guy who pulls teeth for a living.
True. I just pull people through their existential crises instead.
Isn't that what we're really here for? Pulling people through their weekly crisis with a bit of banter and maybe a nugget of wisdom if we accidentally stumble upon one?
Accidental wisdom, our specialty.
Speaking of accidental, I almost accidentally broke the internet this week. I was Googling conspiracy theories, as one does, and stumbled upon the wildest one yet. Did you know, Jeff, that some people out there believe that cheese is a government conspiracy?
Say it ain't so, Tommy. Not cheese. Not the glorious Gouda or the majestic mozzarella.
I know, right? As a Wisconsinite, this one hit me hard. Apparently, there's a small but vocal group that thinks the government is using cheese to control the population.
And here I was thinking cheese was just a delicious dairy product. Who knew it was secretly the Illuminati's weapon of choice?
Exactly. So folks, if you suddenly find yourself craving a grilled cheese sandwich, just remember, you're not hungry, you're being controlled.
Well, I guess that explains why I can't say no to a pizza. It's not my fault, it's the man keeping me down.
The cheese industrial complex at work.
But hey, on the bright side, at least our podcast listeners are in the know. Consider this your weekly dose of truth, folks.
You're welcome, world. And now that we've thoroughly enlightened everyone, let's dive into today's actual conversation. Because believe it or not, we do more than just riff on random topics. Today, we're excited to chat with our guest because, as always, we believe everyone has a story worth sharing.
Yeah, this one's going to be good. So stick around, everyone. And if you haven't already, make sure you've got some cheese nearby, you know, for research purposes.
Exactly. You won't want to miss this. Let's get into it.
All right.
Straight trash.
What you just heard, podcast listeners, by the way, welcome to the podcast. All of that was AI. I don't know if you could tell.
Of course you can tell.
Yeah, you could tell.
Since when have I been waiting till you finish every sentence?
Sure.
For my input.
When am I not saying yeah and laughing into the microphone? Always.
Ha-ha, Tommy, that's very good.
I think my favorite. So we just heard that for the first time, just off the rip.
So it was we found that Wesley, our producer Wesley got that. What did you say? It's generated AI generated it's, AI so written.
I took six of the most recent intros and I transcribed them and then I gave it to the AI and I said, hey, read this. And in the same style, write a script for a new one. And then it was like, tell me about the host. And I was like, sure. Gave him a couple things. And then it was like, okay, here's your script. And then I gave that to Brian. And then Brian fed it to the voice AI. And then he got your voice, which I guess also trained on your voice.
Now, I will say, voices. As I was listening to that, there obviously was like some uncanny valley in terms of like the way that it like stopped and then like
it felt like we were reading a script.
Yes, but like
which it was reading
it was script. Reading a script, but I could actually hear you like you.
Yeah, man, of course you did.
Did I sound like that? The AI? Did it sound like me? Okay.
Pretty I don't know.
Close-ish.
I don't know, Tommy.
I just have so much character, you know. No AI can capture me.
There's nothing quite gets that sultry baritone that
you have. And I feel like they also, like, you can't get that Wisconsin accent just right,
no,
you know. It's like a mixture of weird, you know. So my favorite
nothing's
part about that, I think, was...
Nothing's real anymore is what we're trying to say to you. Nothing is real.
Also, a little alarming that you fed it the scripts of our start and it just went on conspiracy theory about cheese. So we talk about conspiracy.
Doesn't have a lot of sense of humor though.
Yeah. It was a little dry. You said really magnificent good. Mozzarella as an AI and I didn't. The great Gouda. Was that the other one?
Oh, my
It was very cheese.
But you can see how in like 5 years this is going to take over the world.
Or if it was more of
when
a
is the
serious
first AI president?
Whoa,
No, I'm not kidding. Actually, yeah, what point do they create a character who just goes on, they never make public appearances, mm-hmm. and they're just sort of this creation.
Yeah.
It will happen at some point. Somebody will do this. By the way, this
is like Skynet. It's like Terminator.
This feels very much like a Black Mirror episode ready to go.
Okay.
Watch Black Mirror.
No.
Black Mirror is a fascinating show. Please do not hear me as recommending all of the Black Mirror episodes. Some of them have objectionable content. But the idea behind them is remarkable. So it's on Netflix. Black Mirror is the idea that your phone, you hold it up and it's Black Mirror. The idea is that what they'll do is they'll take stories about how technology could go wrong in the present time. So it's stuff that already have the capability of probably doing.
Mm-hmm.
And what would it look like if people actually did that? There are actually some Black Mirror episodes that have come into actually happened. So one of them is the new. Have you seen those dogs? The dogs, the mechanical dogs that look, they're black and they don't really have a head, but they are robot dogs.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. At MIT and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So the ones that don't lose their balance.
There's a story. That one of the stories of it is what if they made it so that these dogs were able to hunt human beings.
Oh.
And they would lock on to a particular target and they would utilize all of their accessibility to Skynet and all this stuff to try to track them down.
I know Skynet.
And they have, they're actually weaponized, these dogs, and they're able to kill their
target.
Yeah.
Wow.
And it could happen. Not only could it happen, right now they're doing some of that weird stuff with drones.
Yeah, it's a lot of drones in Ukraine and Russia.
Yeah.
Yeah, tons.
So they just send a drone out and it goes and finds people. There's also another story on Black Mirror about how they mechanized bees. And the mechanized bees went out and could attack anybody that they... the state or the government sicked them on.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
And yet you're like, actually
the birds aren't real. So the bees might be real. Right. You know,
there are fake trees and
there's fake trees. And
so,
I am actually kind of impressed. While the dialogue was quite clunky on some of those parts, it did have a resemblance of our voice. And so in 5 years, think about that. Like, how long has AI voice been out, Brian Spar? How long has it been out? Like 2 years? Like widespread? Year and a half? 2 years? So if it's come, I mean, technology.
Give it 3 or 4, yeah.
Yeah, give it 3 or 4 more years and you're going to, how would we be able to distinguish reality in terms of some of these things?
You can't, so.
When they start to get better and better and better. What is your take, by the way, Jeff, on AI? Do you like it? Do you dislike it? Is it...
I think like every technological marvel, it has enormous usefulness if used in the right way. But the problem with human beings is that we have a proclivity toward evil and we end up taking things that are good and we use them for their evil applications or for our selfish applications. So it's, the tool itself is not necessarily a bad thing.
Yeah.
Right? It can be used for all sorts of noble things.
Yep.
The problem is, you and I both know that AI will immediately be picked up by the porn industry. It's immediately
it'll be
picked up by nefarious actors in the world to dupe people into believing things that will make those people do wicked things or make those people give money to the... Yeah. I actually think that AI, the fact that we aren't able to actually trust reality, what will end up happening is that there will probably be a response to all of this, and it will be that we end up valuing physical presence way more than we probably have in the past.
Yeah.
So this is,
you can't tell online what's listener, don't even know if it's Jeff and I talking to you right now. This whole thing could be AI.
Think about what could happen in a church though. Okay. So realistically, if we're going to do Black Mirror church episode.
Yeah.
Here's one that you could do. We could create an AI pastor.
Mm-hmm.
We could feed this AI pastor the best sermons from a myriad of sources, uh-huh. right? And then it could learn how to preach engaging, interesting sermons. And then it would end up doing that. with a character, right? So when I was in the 80s, Max Headroom, but like now, it, whatever you want to call it, Pastor Joe could end up being a character who's on a stage and walks around and delivers fascinating sermons that get broadcast by video into churches all over the place. And it's not a real person.
Yeah.
It's not a real pastor. And I actually think this is part of the reason why the video venue kind of thing, which we, listen, at Harvest we utilize, but it's not a long-term solution to churches. You can't, people are going to eventually want to have, they need to know that the person that they're talking to is a real person, or who's talking to them is a real person who has a background and a life. And I think people get so sick of being lied to that they'll want, we actually will in this weird way go back to
the pendulum will swing.
Well, more. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like I wouldn't be surprised.
I could see that.
If more written, you know, non-digital written things become more and more popular as time goes on because it's more personal. Anyway, if that makes sense.
Yeah, totally. That is like a, yeah, I mean, thinking of the implications of that in the future, and not just this area of our life, but in literally every area of our life. Like, how could you ever trust what your eyes are seeing? Mm-hmm. I mean, even now in this day and age, you go on social media and then you watch some other media and it's like, you can't.
No.
Can you really trust what you just saw?
Nah, you don't. It's all
made up. Like, and sometimes it's like, hey, you're telling me the opposite of what I'm seeing.
Yeah.
But some of the other times it's like that person omitted how they edited the entirety of the
content. And then you don't always know if the person who's doing the facts check community notes thing is who's trustworthy in that. And so in the end, again, this is why I think local Christian churches with known Christian pastors who live and work among the people is probably the future of the church in a society where where anybody can make up fake things and fake people and make them say stuff.
Do you?
So word of mouth is already the way I know somebody's going to be good as a plumber or something is almost entirely by word of mouth now. I can go on Google and I can do like the search and, you know, like Google Maps and find out what their rating is.
It could all be bots, though.
Even there.
Yeah, it could be bots.
It could be bots. But if you, Tommy, or as our guest today, Richard, tells me about a restaurant, I'm like, I can believe that.
Yeah.
So,
and if they're wrong, I'll hate you forever. No, I'm just kidding.
Well, I know where to go back and say, hey, that wasn't that good. But
get your taste buds checked.
But again,
my guy.
This is why.
Are they made of robots?
Word of mouth is becoming such a valuable thing.
Yeah.
And
do you subscribe to the like more of the AI is going to be the end of the world, Skynet, Elon Musk, right? We have to keep it in check. We have to make sure that there's controls around it, or more of the other side it's going to be all right. You know,
I've seen movies.
Think it's going to, well, you said
it's going to be self-aware.
Well, it's
Terminator.
Like, do you view AI like you view aliens? Like it can only be evil, right? Aren't you said that, right?
The only good alien is dead one. That's true.
And it's a bad one. Like they don't ever come in peace.
No. Why are they coming?
Yeah.
Stay on your own planet. That's what I say. They're just coming down here, shooting up stuff.
Wanting our oceans.
Totally. That's what they wanted. Why are they here? They're here to harvest our organs and stuff.
Wow. So AI, same idea. Hostile, Skynet.
It's a creation of our creation, though. It's,
us playing God?
Yeah. By the way, we do need to get to our thing, but world do you do education these days, though?
Yeah.
What we should do, Tommy, all right? So here's what, nobody listens to this thing anyway, so listen.
Yeah. Is this a business venture?
Here's a business venture.
All right, entrepreneur.
Here's what we do.
We
tell people, we can earn you
a
bachelor's degree, okay? But think about it for a minute. How many all video, all online bachelor's programs are there now? Okay. Yeah. So what we do is we take all that and we say, we can actually get you a degree. We'll create the digital version of you. Mm-hmm. You will send in
an avatar,
all the stuff, which will all be done by AI, all of the different papers and stuff like that. We'll even create, again, an avatar that looks like you, yeah, and that's a person who they can do the Zoom calls with. Mm-hmm. And then you will actually end up getting the degree without ever doing anything to get it.
Wow.
I am of the opinion
that that will happen.
That we could actually get you straight A's if we could do this.
I yeah.
Yeah.
This is
now we're going to do it.
This is the future. Yeah. That is like,
how else do you think this church is going to pay his debt?
Yeah, that's it. Yeah, yeah. This is a it's for the ethical, listen, ethical madness for the Lord.
No people are getting hurt.
Yeah, only robots.
It's a win-win-win. The university gets the money.
Yep.
We get the money, and the person gets the degree.
Wow.
Which will lead to their money. Good. We've settled that. Speaking of money. Richard Labib is a chief financial officer.
He is. And you guys are going to, he's also an elder in our church.
He is.
And you guys are going to have a conversation. The AI didn't say this, but it's because we believe that everyone has a story. Or maybe it did say that. Mm-hmm. And but you guys are going to have a conversation because we believe that everyone has a story. And Richard certainly has one. You guys are going to talk about that right now.
It didn't say that.
That's right.
That's right.
Let's go.
That's how you know it's real.
We're real. Let's go.
I'm here with Richard Labib. Richard, what's your... I ask people often what their middle name is. What is your middle name?
That's a good question. Technically, it's just the letter S.
What do you mean, technically?
So it's a long story. So I'm a son of an immigrant. And there was a lot of, I guess, debate on what they should name me. And so for a short period of time, I was Sammy Labib after my father and my grandfather.
Wow.
And then my grandmother stepped
in. Okay, when you say a long period of time, like you were alive during this time?
Yeah, like for 4 whole days.
All right, you were Sammy Labib, and then what?
I was Sammy Labib, and then my grandma stepped in. She said, no, he needs an American name, like an English name. And so she offered up Richard Nixon's name because he was the president and gave me an opportunity to become president one day. And then
how's that going?
It's going fantastic. And then my dad's like, no, I always wanted to name, you know, a kid David.
Oh.
And so you could see who my grandma won.
Yeah.
And so I became
the matriarch. She took over.
So they moved the Sammy to the middle.
Okay.
And technically it's just an S.
So on all your documents, it's Richard S. Labib.
Absolutely. And so when we had my son, traditionally, you know, you name your son after your dad in our culture.
Mm-hmm.
And so we named my son Sammy. And so I thought it would be cool then to include Sammy as my middle name, you know, out of respect to my dad and my grandpa, who are Sammys.
Okay.
And so I added it. I had a passport renewal, and I added Sammy in there. And that's the whole story.
So how do you add in a passport renewal? Do you just fill out the little middle portion where it says middle name? You just, instead of going S, you go Sammy.
I went Sammy, and then my mom found a birth certificate that showed my name as Sammy.
Who?
So I kept that. So they figured out a way somehow to change my name to Richard. Maybe they didn't file the piece of paper at the hospital. I don't know.
You have a lot. So in other words, you might be on file.
Could be.
With the government as Sammy Labib.
That would be awesome. I would love that.
And here you've been living as a Richard all these years.
Yeah.
Dude, you could think about the potential of law breaking that could take place here.
I could restart.
You could.
I could.
Wow.
Yeah, it'd be good.
Where are you from? So what culture are you referring to when you say that the traditions are?
It's a good question. So on my mom's side, her mom's Armenian and her dad's Jordanian.
Okay.
And on my dad's side, they're Egyptian through and through. So how did that mix happen? And, you know, it's a product of the U.S. So it's actually a cool story. Boy meets girl in another country at a Bible conference. Then boy meets girl again in the U.S. in Chicago. And they get married.
On purpose?
No. In the U.S., I think it was an accident.
So, like, this is like a special, this is a providential thing. Like,
it's actually a sweet story. I'll share my parents' story. It's okay. And so I'll do it in like 15 seconds. Okay. My mom went to a Bible conference in Egypt, and she met this young guy, Sam. Sam liked her, and he wrote in her, like, you know, they used to do this thing where they'd give like a notebook and everybody would sign, hey, best wishes, stay in touch.
Yep.
And he wrote in there, you know, I'm going to be a pharmacist in 1971 and I'm going to come marry you. And then fast forward, and like a decade passed. And so all of my mom's cousins came to the U.S. to go to college and grad school. And so she was visiting her brother. She went to Tennessee Temple, mm-hmm. and she came to visit her brother who was at the University of Illinois. And my dad was friends with her brother. And then they met each other.
Wow.
And they said, wow, hey. And then
The University of Illinois?
And they got married. Well, River West would be the neighborhood, kind of like where all the Italians and Greek village sort of met. That's sort of where they lived. And UIC is just, I don't know, maybe seven blocks away from there.
Okay.
And that's the story. And then they stayed.
In Chicago.
And a year later, Richard was here.
How many siblings do you have?
I have one brother younger, Michael.
How much younger?
4 years.
Okay.
Yeah, but 4 years growing up felt like, you know.
Long time.
Yeah, he reminds me all the time, you know, growing up, I'm not his dad.
And so really?
There's that dynamic. Okay. But now we're like best friends. And
all right. And they still live.
They do.
Are your parents still alive?
My parents are. So that's they live great. In Chicago. They're retired. They're still there. And they commute to their grandkids. So 2-3 days a week, they come visit me. And then 2-3 days a week, they visit Mike. And then they alternate attending church with us.
It's like an all-American story.
It's kind of a cute story.
It is.
Yeah.
This is the story of so many Americans, absolutely. Right? Regardless of when you got here.
Yeah.
You come from immigrant family.
Yeah.
It showed up in the U.S. for some reason, usually to further their life interest in some way.
Absolutely.
And then they get stuck in a city. Especially from that part of the world, coming to a major city like that and finding a community of people who are like-minded or from similar backgrounds and then grew up in that kind of environment. So you grew up in a tight-knit Armenian/Egyptian community?
So most of my mom's family was still overseas. And so we grew up, you know, in Chicago, my brother and I, and our community was actually a lot of evangelical Arabic churches. Hmm. So there were all these little church plants all across Chicago. And so our weekend consisted of Saturday, we'd go to, you know, the Brethren Church at Barry, you know, Saturday afternoon, we would be at the Nazarene Church in Elmwood Park. And Sunday we'd go to Moody. Then Sunday night we'd go to another Middle Eastern church.
Holy smokes, that's and a lot so, of church.
Yeah, my dad had a thing with, you know, he didn't believe you should be a church member. He felt like you should attend all the churches in your community.
Wow.
And so we went to like 2-3, you know, Middle Eastern churches. And then Michael and I struggled with the language, and so he would take us to Moody on Sundays.
Okay.
And so that's kind of how we grew up.
So would you consider Moody as your the church that you kind of came from then?
Yeah, or? I love Erwin Lutzer. I view him as like my first pastor. Huh? It's the first church I joined out of my own volition. And, you know, we attended, you know, we were there. We were committed. And all the way until, you know, I met my wife and we got married and somehow we became suburbanites.
You met your wife at Moody?
I met my wife. It's another story. I met my wife, in college. I saw her and I just went to go talk to her.
What college did you attend?
Northeastern for undergrads.
Okay.
And
where's that?
It's a commuter school. It's in the middle of the city.
Okay.
And so.
Because there's a Northeastern university like up in Boston. Not that one.
I love outside of Illinois. People think I went to Northeastern. And I'm like, yeah, Northeastern.
Yeah.
I don't have to add the Illinois part. But it's a mediocre commuter school in the heart of the city.
Uh-huh.
And usually people who work or are older or planning on going back to school, that's usually where they go. A lot of people spend a couple of years there and then they eventually go to another university. I decided to stay because I liked it.
Okay.
So I met Jenny.
You got your bachelor's degree from that?
I did. I got a bachelor's degree from there. And then later on, you know, I continued school somewhere else.
Where?
I went to Roosevelt and I got a master's degree.
Okay. Business.
Yeah. Accounting.
Okay. Very exciting.
It is. I love it. It's so organized.
I bet. It just makes you feel good getting all those things in their little boxes on the spreadsheet.
There's a sense of completion every month. Yeah. And so when I think about other people's jobs, and so, like, I liken you to, you know, like a CEO. So vision, leadership, mission. Yep. And so you are always, you know, like this. And you don't have end
dates. Like what?
Well, you have goals.
I'm sorry, it's audio.
You're always working towards something.
Oh, okay.
And you're always trying to get people to get somewhere. And you're always trying to execute a strategy. So there's really no end date. There's like these loose timelines for a lot of what you're doing.
It's very irritating.
I think it's kind of cool.
Well, I'm glad you do.
I think it's cool.
It would be nice to have a sense of completion at some point. That's why you want little, checkpoints. But you know what? You don't usually have them when you're as haphazard as I am.
But you can take vacations easier than I can.
That's probably
true. My whole
life
is so structured. So the last week and the first week of every month, first 6 weeks of every fiscal year, I can't do anything. Everybody knows.
I do want to talk to you about how you got into finance and the business that you're currently in, but I am particularly interested in how it is that you met your wife. You just walked up to her after, this was not at Northeastern though?
No, she was sitting. She was like studying something. At Northeastern, she was at a table.
She's a student as well.
Yeah.
And so, how much, same age?
No, 4 year difference.
So you're older?
I'm older, yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
Like your brother's age?
She's my brother's age. They're a few months apart.
So you saw her sitting there.
I did, and I thought she was lovely.
Yep.
And I went and just started trying to talk to her, and she was, you know, busy trying to study. So I thought, hey, I glanced over what she was working on, and, you know, I tried to participate in a way that I'm helping her out. And
is that a blue? You were like,
I was trying, you know, operations research, who's your professor, you know, blah, blah, blah. And she just completely ignored me. So I walked away. And then I went and sat down. I found a table. I sat down, and then I saw her looking around, and I took that as an invitation to try again. And so I just got up, I walked over, and I sat down, and we just started talking. And so,
sometimes women just look around, though.
I know, but I needed an. I needed an excuse to go up to her.
Yeah, and, you know what? Try again.
I was smitten, and I was on mission.
Mm-hmm.
And so I went over, I sat down, and I just started, you know, how can I get the conversation going? So I asked her, you know, where she's from, this and that, and she volunteered that she was Palestinian.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, I know some Palestinians. I know this person and that person. And then I asked her what her last name was, and she shared that with me. And I said, oh, I know a guy. His name is so-and-so. And she said, wow, that's my first cousin.
Oh, wow.
And I said, he's a friend of mine.
And you're in.
And I thought I was in. She's really tough. And then I said, you know, some strange thing. I was at a wedding like 5 years ago, and it was a cousin of mine who married somebody with your last name. And she said, oh, my goodness, is your cousin, you know, so-and-so? And I said, yeah. She's like, I stood up at that wedding. I'm like, wow, I was there. And then she was nice to me.
Yeah.
And then so.
You were a known quantity now.
Yeah. So now it's like for her, I had some leverage because she didn't want to be rude to me and me tell people, hey, you know, Jenny's a rude person. So she was polite.
Yeah.
And then so we spoke for a few weeks, and then we liked each other.
Yeah.
We met each other's parents.
How would she tell this story differently than what you did?
Honestly, I think I've heard her tell this story. And I think it's 80% the same.
Okay.
You know, she will add, hey, this guy was really persistent. You know, and he sat down and I was trying to be polite. And so, so her version's funnier.
Yeah.
And so, but I like my version.
Yeah. Well, yours is obviously the truth.
I think so.
So, you met each other's parents. Like how is there a particular kind of like courting ritual in your background, or is that, I mean, cause it's interesting being, the child of immigrants, recent immigrants, is that you're holding on to your parents, background, right? As they move, cause this is what they know. It's their background, and you're kind of part of this new world.
Yeah.
And so I'm often interested to find out, okay, what was growing up like and what kind of rituals and stuff did you have to go through when it comes to like marrying or courting your spouse?
So that's really interesting. You're going to be disappointed in this. And so my dad very much assimilated and he became an American and he encouraged us to be American. And so my mom wanted us to be cultured. So every summer she would take us overseas. And that's how we learned the language and we met our family and met our cousins. One of the things that Jenny liked about me is that I was very Americanized.
Oh.
And so Jenny was extremely traditionalist and she came from a very traditionalist family. And so when we liked each other, she took me over to meet her dad. And so I have a cousin who is half Palestinian. My mom's sister married a Palestinian.
Mm-hmm.
So he was basically my coach on culture. And I had a, Palestinian, Jordanian, Middle Eastern culture for dummies, how to court a girl and talk to her family. And so he was coaching me. It's my cousin Bernard. Same similar story to me. They gave an American name, so and so on. And so I went and I met her dad, and I sat down. And the way that you date in this culture is you get to know people. There's no really dating. It's really talking.
Yeah.
And then once you have some similarities, you go through a formal process where you bring your parents over.
Oh.
And they have a
conversation. Like your parents.
My parents. With I had to go. Parents. I'm like, Dad, you need to muster up all of the Arabic you have in you. And we're gonna go. And so my mom was very happy with it. She's, you know, a proud Jordanian American.
Yeah.
And, you know, she. So we went over and, you know, they basically vouch for you. Mm-hmm. And they say, hey, my son is so and so and blah, 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 and this and that. And we love your daughter and we'd like, you know. So, and then the dad blesses it right then and there. Then we can date. Huh. And so then we date, but our dating also was very old school. Our dating, Jenny and I, consisted of me hanging out with her and her brothers at their house. Nice. And getting to know her whole family.
Yeah.
And so that's how we dated. And but I'd say, you know, we met September.
So you just go for dinner?
Dinner. And we hang out and talk.
Okay.
And in this culture, like, you know, one of my favorite things about the culture is that they really believe you marry into the family.
Yeah.
And so it's really important to, you know, love your in-laws and from them from love you and have an understanding and so on and so on. And so you take some time, you know, to make sure everything works well.
Yeah.
And so we did that. And then we had to have a proper engagement. It's like, you know, I think of a betrothal because we tried to do it. So her family's all Orthodox and my family is, you know, evangelical. And I wanted to, you know, have a lot of respect for her family. And so I tried to incorporate as many of the traditions as possible and to make sure that they were biblically sound.
Mm-hmm.
And so we decided to have an engagement. And I had, you know, three pastor friends of mine. And they came and, you know, they picked the Bible stories. And then we had witnesses and we had, you know, we exchanged rings and we blessed the rings. And we did all of these things with a promise, you know, that we were going to get married, that we were going to work towards, you know, getting married.
Yeah, this is not happening on your wedding day. This is happening a year out or something to that effect. This happened
8 months before.
8 months before.
Yeah. And then we spend, and once that happens, you know, Jenny is tagged as, you know, future bride of Richard. And Richard's tagged as, you know, future husband of Jenny. And everybody in the community knows that, and the churches and everything. And they all support, you know, you guys working towards getting married. And it's I think it's really cool.
Okay, so now you have children.
Yeah, I do.
And you have to face the future with the possibility that they are not going to be involved in that kind of courting ritual.
Yeah.
Tell me what they're going to miss out on.
Yeah.
And also what you're happy they're going to miss out on.
So I love that you asked that. I am, they're not going to miss out on anything because since they were really young, I've been training them in the traditions.
Oh, good.
And so the idea is, you know, I imagine, you know, Sam, for example, he's my oldest, he's 16. So we're plus or minus, you know, 10 years and a couple of years of him getting married. And so if he marries somebody who doesn't have these traditions, we'll together celebrate some of these traditions.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that would be fun.
Mm-hmm.
And I've taken him with me to a lot of these events, and he thinks they're wonderful. I think these traditions are important because, you know, in our community, when you get married, it's forever. You fight for it. You work hard to incorporate family and culture. Name and legacy is important. Investing in your children is important. And I think those are all really good, you know, lessons for anybody. And, things that I, you know, now that I'm thinking about it, there is something he would miss. And, you know, if he stayed away from it is the expense.
Hmm.
It's expensive.
Yeah.
It's expensive to have a 500 person wedding. It's expensive to have, you know, hundreds of people at an engagement party.
Mm-hmm.
You know, these things cost a lot of money. So I take it back. You know, it just, it's been so long and Jenny's been absolutely worth it.
Yeah.
But the expense, I think.
Well, there's some things that are worth spending money on, right?
Jenny's totally worth it, but yeah. I don't know if I'd obligate anybody to spend that kind of money.
Spend that money on their bride.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, it's the wedding, you know, and if I could spend it directly on Jenny, it'd be a different story.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When you were growing up, did you, like what kinds of things were you into?
All kinds of stuff. When I always look back at my life, I view myself as a generalist. So from sports, you know, I had like groups of friends and growing in Chicago. And they have different cultures and different interests. So I had my nerdy friends. So I loved comic books and
which
Nintendo.
Comic?
So my favorite comic book character is Batman. So I still really? Have. I do. I love him. He's a regular guy. He's super smart.
Yeah.
And that's what
just
I like about him.
He gets beat up all the time.
But you can be Batman. Well, you can't be Superman. You can't be
any. That's true. I can't.
You can be Batman. You can be Iron Man.
I could.
Those two guys are amazing.
Yeah. Yeah. Need some money. But yeah.
Yeah, but you can get sponsored by somebody, you know, and you know.
Okay.
Elon Musk could find
you. Looking, listen, I'm
Elon
I'm
Musk in. Can be Iron Man.
I am looking to become a caped vigilante.
Could do it.
I want you to
you
know that.
You could, but you couldn't be any of the other superheroes.
Yeah.
So I loved Batman. And so he didn't quite like attention. So Bruce Wayne never got, nobody knew who Bruce Wayne was. You know, he was a spoiled rich guy. So he was able to do all the things that he needed to do, you know, sort of under the guise of, you know, the bat, the vigilante bat.
Yeah.
And he was really smart about it. And he yeah. kept his secrets and he didn't need to be patted on the back.
So did you collect some of these comics?
Yeah, I do. It's funny that...
Do you still have them?
So here's what happened. So I've packed all this stuff. I packed music. I was also into music and video games, but I packed all of my stuff into boxes before Jenny and I, you know, got married, because eventually I had to take the stuff out of my parents' house. Yep. So I packed it all up and I moved it with me, and then I moved it with me again. Mm-hmm. And so I'm trying to clear out stuff. And I volunteered one of my kids, hey, if you help me out here, whatever, you might find a treasure in here. So I started opening boxes. Guess what's in there? All my comics.
Nice.
All my baseball cards, all my CDs and LPs.
Yeah.
And I thought it was kind of great.
It is kind
of
great.
Yeah. A big chunk of it is on eBay. Nobody's interested. So obviously.
I have special meaning to you.
But yeah, so I do have a lot of that.
What was your favorite band then that you liked? What kinds of music were you listening to?
So The music that I love the most was like electronic, new wave music. Nice. 80s.
Yeah.
So from
English beat.
I love all the English. I was an Anglophile. I love from Depeche Mode to New Order, Richard, and Joy Division. So what's weird
were you
is
sad
that you can't.
When you were young.
I'm still sad. No, I'm kidding.
Melancholy.
But, very melancholy. But I have, so it's hard to say that because there's lots of music that I liked. I also love hip hop.
Okay.
So old hip hop. Well, not really old, but like late 80s, you know, De La Soul, all those guys. I also loved industrial music.
Okay.
I also love jazz. So I think it's
eclectic.
Yes, it is eclectic. But if I had to pick one album.
You have to have, this is a good, yeah, you have to have one. You're going to listen to it forever on your desert island.
Yeah. So based on that box that Christian and I opened mm-hmm. and went through, the majority of what's in there is 80s new wave electronic music.
That would be your choice.
So it'd probably be Depeche Mode.
So if you have Spotify and stuff, you got like a playlist like that? Do you listen to music still?
So I don't. I listen, I'm really boring. It's all praise and worship music. So if you saw all of my albums, the reason for that, everybody's different. So for me personally, you know, all that music puts me in a mindset that's different than the mindset I want to be in. Okay. And so I use music to help
me. Depeche Mode does that to you.
Oh my gosh. You know, odd. You know what's weird? Being a believer and listening to Depeche Mode, I always had this idea of writing a letter to one of the writers. And like, you're so close. Like, you're so close to getting
Why
this.
Are you thinking about all these things and singing?
So, yeah, it's like when emptiness. A believer watches Narnia versus, mm-hmm. you know, and so, but that, you know, for me personally, you know, it's good to kind of just stay away from that stuff.
Yeah.
Not listen to it too much. I enjoy it every once in a while. You know, a kid asks me, hey, what was your favorite song? Hey, check this out.
Yeah.
You know, but yeah.
Okay.
Music.
But you said you were interested in all sorts of stuff. So other things or any other arts that you were interested in?
So photography.
Okay.
You know, I did a lot of photography from probably...
What did you take pictures of? Everything?
So I was a Chicagoan, and I really like taking like portraits of people doing things, whether it's in the park or... Mm. And then the other thing I like to do is find rundown buildings.
Yeah.
And try to find, you know, an opportunity where it's dark and you have to leave like the f-stop open mm-hmm. and absorb as much light as you can,
mm-hmm.
you know, and to develop a picture or nighttime photography without flash.
Mm.
So I did that probably from the age of 10, 11, 12 until
10 years old.
18.
Did you have your own dark room?
So my dad was into photography.
Okay.
And he gave me all this stuff. And so I used to take the pictures and get them developed. And then when I got to high school, I was 12. And so in high school they had a audio video club and they had a photography club. So I joined that. And then, so you get all of your free,
yeah.
You know, and so you even got equipment, which was kind of great. Yeah. So my dad gifted me his equipment. I still have the equipment too. That was one of the boxes.
What's the best picture you've ever taken?
So I have a couple of cool ones. I have one. It's hung up in my office at home. It was a factory off Pulaski on the south side. and the roof was collapsing. Mm-hmm. And inside of it, it was kind of cool because it looked, you know, very industrial. Think of like Batman's garage, back to that. And then you had, you know, in the center, you had this light come in. And I had to leave, you know, the aperture open for such a long time that you see dust particles from the sunlight touching. It's a really cool picture.
I would like to see this picture.
I will show it to you. I will show it to you. But that's my favorite picture.
What's the best picture that you've seen? Like if you could own a photograph, yeah, and put it on your wall.
There's a lot. You know, there's photographers that I used to like, and I don't, you know, I don't remember a lot of things because I've been away from this for so long. But I remember like Annie Leibovitz. You know, I loved almost everything she did. She did a lot of portraits of, like she took a strange foot picture,
yeah,
and you'd look at it and it ended up being like Pele's foot.
Yeah.
And, you know, that kind of stuff, you know, yeah, things that make you think, you know, where you accidentally prejudge or have a bias and then you're pleasantly surprised.
So that's, you liked all those digitized weird pictures where you had to cross your eyes to see.
Sure, yeah, my eyes are still crossed.
This one's never. I could never do them.
This one never recovered.
Were you always able to do those? You know which ones I'm talking about?
I do, like where you stare into it and, you know.
And all of a sudden people say, oh my gosh, I can see this such and such, which I'm sure is a lie because I've never seen it. I think it's just a digitized mess.
I feel like you tell yourself and you can see it. Like, you know, though, have you ever heard this? Whatever word you're reading, you hear it in your head?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I mean, I always hear both words.
Yeah.
You know, and I don't know. It's a good question. But yeah.
I think it's one of the first conspiracies, Richard.
Really?
Yeah, I think people looked into that, seemed way more willing to take COVID stuff than I'm kidding.
that's a good
They were
point.
Setting us up, Richard.
I took the COVID shot, it worked.
Years ago.
It worked.
Right, so did you want to be an accountant?
No, I didn't. But so my dad is a pharmacist. And mm-hmm. so I wasn't interested in science and at all. And so I didn't know. I had a really good friend whose father was like an executive at a company in Chicago. And he would always talk accounting. And he said, you know, accounting's a really good tool. If you don't know what you want to do, you know, get an accounting degree.
Because
you could get into finance, whatever you want to do in business, accounting at least, he used to always say it's a science and a tool.
Yeah.
Unlike business administration, you know, which is theory that always gets updated. Science is, accounting.
Numbers are numbers. Yeah. Economy.
It's also logic and it's principle based and there are rules and everybody needs, you know, information.
Yeah.
And everybody needs to translate all of this, you know, into numbers so you can have a common language. I thought that was cool. And so his name was Mirno. He's an Italian guy and I admired him and he would, you know, take the time to coach me. You should study this. You should learn that. You should do this. And so I didn't quite take his advice at first. I went and, you know, did other stuff. I tried to be a banker. I tried to open a restaurant.
What kind of restaurant?
It's like, QSRs. There were like Subways. So I tried that.
You opened a Subway?
Yeah, a couple of them. And
What went wrong?
Well, what went wrong is it's 7 days a week, 12 hours.
Okay, so it wasn't the sales of the Subway stuff.
Every Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, teenagers would not come to work.
Really?
And it was just, and so it was a tough life. And well, the reason why I transitioned out of it is because I found myself just doing accounting all day long.
Mm.
And so I hear Mirno's voice in my head and, maybe I should pursue this.
Mm.
And so I did. And, so it worked out well. Gave me, you know, cognition. It was a nice career.
You currently work as a chief financial officer.
I do.
For a German company.
I do. They're a German freight forwarding and logistics company, yes.
And they have a large presence in the United States?
So they're in 13 cities and in Canada as well. And they're in 32 countries overall. But I would say from a large presence, I'm talking dollars, or we're a middle market freight forwarder.
Mm.
So if you look at the top 30, we'll be, you know, somewhere between 15 and 20.
Okay.
You know?
So what is it like working for a German company as opposed to working for an American company?
It's a great question.
What are the strengths and relative weaknesses?
So for me personally, I think it's lovely to work for a multinational.
Mm.
You get a lot of culture and I think that's fantastic. I like people, you know, I like food. I like variety in life.
Okay. And German food, though?
German food's delicious, but, you know, our offices are in 32 countries. So it's not just German food, but yeah. German food. I mean, German food is sausage.
Yeah, I know. I know. I've spent a good long time in Austria, been to Germany lots of times.
Yeah.
I just could never fall in love with the pork addiction. It's just a little much for me.
Okay. Well, they also have beef.
They do.
They have like the roulade that's rolled up.
They do. You know what they do though?
Their version of spaghetti.
Yes. They've got some fantastic spaghetti.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And their bread is delicious.
The bread.
The coffee is good.
There it is.
Cake. I'm going to win you over.
The best cake I've ever had is German chocolate cake in the world. But I don't ever recall. If you told me we're going to go out to a German meal, I'd be like, come on, man. Look, there's so many other places. It's not quite British food, which
is the worst
food.
Yeah. Stew.
Right. I got to tell you something really short. Yeah. When we lived in New Zealand, right? Because their heritage is from the British, right? Yeah. And the food largely is that way too. My wife shows up there and she starts cooking. You know, of course you cook stuff that you know.
Yeah.
And so she's finding stuff and, you know, for us, garlics and all the stuff. And so she's cooking and she becomes known as this like amazing cook in New Zealand.
Yeah.
And people are like, you got to go to Jeannie's house. And just, I don't know what it is about the food that she makes. It just tastes so good. And so anyway, we ended up getting to know some dear friends whose wife was also thought to be a really great cook. And I figured out one day what it was. And the answer, it was that they put garlic in their food.
Wow.
And everyone else did not. So they would make like a roast.
Yeah.
And the roast would just have potatoes, the meat.
Yeah.
That's it.
Wow.
That's it, buddy. And my wife would be like, feels like it should have like
something,
garlic in there or something to flavor it. Yeah, she'd throw some garlic and people were like, what is going on? You should open a restaurant.
I love that story.
And so apparently the British aren't aware of garlic.
They're not aware of a lot of things.
Yeah.
You know, thank God they're aware of deep frying food.
Yes.
So that's good, right? You're not going to go hungry.
They do real well with the fish.
They do.
Also, a hot dog in New Zealand is not a hot dog like it is here.
Yeah.
It's actually a fried Frankfurter-ish sort of thing.
Like a fried sausage.
Yeah.
That sounds fantastic.
So when you go into the fish and chip shop and it says hot dog, you're like, well, I don't want to eat fish and chips. I'll try their hot dog. You get the hot dog and you're like, what in the world is this?
It's a deep fried hot dog?
It's a deep fried sausage type thing.
So you guys were talking earlier about setting up some kind of AI.
Yeah, man.
I think you should go, forget that. Okay. I think you should go with the deep fried hot dogs.
Yeah.
That would be amazing.
Yeah. We could sell them at fairs, I think.
Everywhere. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, Americans would really kick it. We could set up shop in Alabama or something. We'd make bank.
I think people would love a deep fried hot dog.
Yeah. Richard, you're a foodie though.
I love food.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you have a lot of knowledge about different kinds of foods and a lot of hole in the wall restaurants. So here's what I need from you.
Sure.
I need you to recommend a few hole in the wall restaurants and preferably in the Chicago suburbs. Most of the people who are going to listen to this are not hanging out down in the city and there's lots of great places to go eat in the city that you could be like, oh, this great place has been there 50 years. Tell me something. You live out in Huntley for some
reason. I live close to Huntley, Gilbert's.
Although Huntley's got all sorts of really great
food.
Huntley
is way better than Gilbert's. They have like a downtown.
Yes. And there's a barbecue place downtown.
There's a DC Cobb they opened recently. And Huntley's actually a cool place.
Okay.
Yeah. I chose wrong.
Okay.
20 years ago.
So here's what I need though. Recommend to some places that you'd be like, yeah, you're going to love this.
Well, it depends like what you have a taste for.
I am asking you to recommend.
And how far are you willing to drive?
Sure.
Okay. So like if you want Italian food, it's hard. Jenny loves Italian food. It's very hard to find good. I don't want to insult anybody.
No. You just your point of view.
Yeah, I don't want to have missed out something. So I'm going to go like 15 miles away from my house.
Okay.
I might have skipped somebody. You're fantastic too. But like Villa Verona in Geneva is fantastic.
For Italian food.
For Italian food is absolutely fantastic. Yeah.
Okay.
So that place is fantastic. If you like, you know, hole in the wall. It's not really hole in the wall. Alfaro's in Elgin is really good for Mexican.
We're getting like massive head nods around the room right now. They're all nodding their heads about Alfaro's
Praise
Mexican.
The Lord. Thank you guys.
What does Alfaro's do Mexican? wise that's so good?
So it's what's cool about it when you go in there, they barely speak English. That's mm-hmm. positive.
Usually,
and then there's a lot of like you know Mexican guys are eating, positive.
Mm-hmm.
And they do tacos, burritos. You know, if you're healthy, you know I go through these want to be perfectly healthy streaks. So you can get like a steak taco bowl, salad bowl, and it's fantastic. And next door there's a cool ice cream shop.
Okay.
You know, and so it's actually pretty good. El Faro's in Elgin. I think it's 25 or 30. The head nodder. Is it 25 or 31? I don't remember.
But the highway.
I know how to get there.
The road? 31.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. And then so, I mean, we could do this.
And
I mean,
then?
And then, so if you like, I mean, it's hard. Other stuff, it starts getting a little hard.
Okay. Stuff that's more Mediterranean.
So Mediterranean, I haven't found really, so Mediterranean in general. There's, if you're willing to try Pakistani food.
Yes.
Yeah. So there's a place, if you go to Randall all the way down to Silver Glen.
Okay.
There's a Pakistani fast food place. And I'm trying to remember the name of it. I'm going to have to text it to you. Okay. Can you, after this edit, like use AI and edit the name and have me say the name of the place?
No, but we can bring it up next time. Don't
worry. Okay, perfect. Perfect. Yeah. And so if you like that, but if you want like Arabic Israeli food.
Yeah.
You have to go to Schaumburg. And there's two places that I would recommend.
I think I've been to one of them with you, and I've been back several times.
So that
times.
Was the Israeli place.
Yes.
Yeah, Ben Yehud is awesome. Go. It's fantastic. And if you want the same food with a little bit of a, you know, a northern Israeli, Lebanese, Syrian spice to it, there's a place called, it's an interesting, Yummy Kitchen.
Yes.
Yes, it's good. It's good. It's authentic.
I ate there once, and of course, it's some of my favorite food in the world is that part of the world. So
you know, everybody I take likes the food.
Yeah.
And the third place is a place called Mezmiz.
Mezmiz.
And it's in Elk Grove Village on Meacham.
Okay.
And it's like a family run place and it's fantastic. And the people are super nice and sweet.
I love it.
And it's a super authentic.
So if you run across Richard, I'm not gonna lie to you. This guy knows everything there is to know about all the restaurants.
It's just, and I like food.
Would also enjoy your recommendations because he's game for trying other things.
At least once. I'll try anything once.
Yeah.
You know? And I prefer that somebody vouches for it and I go with them.
Yes.
So I could you know, absolutely. Read them.
Well, the meals I've had with you at any location, because I think you and I have a similar interest in hole in the wall, not common, family run. Like we're trying to make a living here.
Absolutely.
Restaurants. And I absolutely love that kind of stuff a lot.
Yeah.
You've been a Christian your whole life.
Yeah. And so, I have been since I was young, but, you know, the experience, like from a testimony perspective for me, it wasn't about, you know, when did I become a Christian? Is it about when I really understood what grace was?
Okay.
So, I mean, it's an interesting story. The story is, you know, born and raised Christian home, parents are believers, et cetera. And so I grew up in churches and I knew that, you know, on the weekends, hey, this is what we did during the week. When I was very young, my parents had a lot of influence over my environment. So then school happened and, you know, like middle schoolish and people had things like, you know, Nintendo.
Yeah.
And I was like, wow, that's cool. And so, you know, you meet friends, you go to an arcade and, my parents would be like, hey, who are your friends? You have to bring them over. I'm like, sure. Okay. I'll do that. And so I started inviting my friends over and my mom, you know, typical mom, she would, cook food and, she would invite the kids to fill a plate and she'd tell them about Jesus. And you know how that would go for me.
Yeah.
And so I would go to school the next day and it's like, you know, if the way the Chicago public schools are, you have all these desks and you put them together and you have this array of culture. So I remember in the sixth grade, I had, you know, Nirmal, and he was Punjabi. Then I had, you know, a guy named Mike Haddad. He was Orthodox. Then I had Anthony, and Anthony was a Latin American Catholic. Then I had Premi, he was a Cuban. It was awesome. Yep. So I would go visit their families, and their families, for the most part, were cool. There was one that I visited. I won't say the name. And the mom grabbed me, and she said to me, hey, you know, I feel really bad for you. Your parents are brainwashing you. The only reason why you believe what you believe is because you've been conditioned from a young child. And if you look at what people believe in, it's usually whatever home they come out of, that's what they believe. Hmm. So why don't you think about why the Muslim kid's a Muslim and why the blah, 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 blah. Yeah. And I was like, what the heck? I'm like, I can't tell my parents this. They'll never let me hang out with so-and-so.
Yeah.
And so, but it planted a seed in my head. And so what I started doing, and this is young, this is sixth grade. So sixth grade for me was like 10 years old. And so I just started thinking about, like, what does that mean exactly? And I was surrounded with family who were, like, involved in ministry. So, like, my mom grew up singing in a church, and my cousins, doing all this stuff, playing in band. And I'm like, man, I'm probably not a Christian because I'm not doing this stuff, you know? And so it confused me. So I started studying and learning and asking people questions, you know, about what they believed in. And because I was convinced, you know, you are what you've been raised in. And, but I could never, like, shake off Jesus. So I was high school, I was the guy hanging out with people, New Wavers on Belmont Avenue, and we'd be at Scenes Cafe. And I had all of these weird compromises. Like, you know, they would smoke pot. So I don't want to smoke pot. So I'd smoke a cigarette, you know, they would, I'd have a coffee, and these are the ways I would justify hanging out with them.
Yeah.
And we would have conversations, and we would talk about religion, and we'd talk about philosophy, and I would always go back to the Bible. And I couldn't shake it off. Like, I knew it was real, but I also knew I had a lot of, what's the word, empathy for all of these other people. Anyway, fast forward a little bit. I had a friend, and she basically, we were talking, and I was walking through, you know, John 1, and there's this cool thing. I couldn't figure it out. I'm not a theologian, but, you know, in the beginning was the Word was God, the Word was God. And then you go to, in the beginning, you know, God created the heavens and the earth. And, but he chose words, you know, to bring things into existence. And I'm like, wow, that's cool. Do you see this? You know, I'm all excited by myself, 14 years old. And and she turned to me and she's like, you're the most screwed up person I ever met in my life. I'm like, what are you talking about? She's like, you're just like us. You do everything that we do. And, but you're always telling us about Jesus and Christians. And like, dude, like, you know, you're like the biggest, most amazing hypocrite I've ever met in my life. Your whole, everything you believe is because you don't do any of the things you believe in. I'm like, wow, that's like crushed me. So I started having like a nightmare. You know, it was weird. It's funny. Like, I was left behind. That's another story for another time. And so I didn't know what to do. And, you know, that my friend's mother really impacted me. And so I'm like, man, I've grown up in churches. All I've heard are sermons. All I've heard, I've read all these books, and I need to detox. And so the way I detoxed was I basically had, I needed to find a Bible that I could just read clearly. And it was an NIV. And I just read it cover to cover. I'm like, you know, the Trinity, like, you know, where's the verse that says, talks about the Trinity? And so just, where's the verse that talks about how am I saved? Like, do I have to pick it or am I picked?
Yeah.
You know? And so I did that for a couple of years. And I realized something. I realized, wait a minute, you are a believer. You just weren't living for the Lord. And I experienced grace. And that was my, I don't know how to describe it. It was like, you know, rocket fuel.
Yeah.
For clarity. I still had to undo a lot of things in my life. And what happened was I started, you know, every year passing, just learning more, growing in my identity. I have to remind myself of that.
Yeah.
And, you know, when you know, the Spirit himself witnesses to your spirit that you're a son of God. And all of those doubts and all of that confusion and all of that searching, you know, was really part of, you know, me trying to, and the Lord using all of those experiences so I can experience him.
Yeah.
And I thought that was cool when I look back at it.
Yeah.
But I always, my testimony, I feel like, man, people have these awesome things where they were this and then boom, and then they did this. But what did Richard do? Richard knew this, he did that, and he came back. And so, but I love it and I'm grateful for it because all those experiences, you know, helped me be a good dad, helps me share all that. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, all those things I went through, all those thoughts I had, you know, I'm able to very clearly walk my kids through it or friends through it.
Without a doubt.
And so,
also, you know, sometimes we limit our testimony to the to just the story of conversion. It's a very evangelical kind of approach to the thing. But your testimony is what you've been talking about the whole time. It's about what God's been doing in your life, even since you're little, and how you came about. And ever, I mean, part of the reason I do this podcast is because every testimony is interesting. Everybody's story, everybody's, then there's similarities between them. And then there's some significant differences as well. I actually, Richard, I'm actually going at Sherry, and I want to make sure, I'm going to have you back. And
what happened?
The reason, and here's why. Here's why.
Yeah.
I've interviewed some people and they've told me their story, and then there's a piece that I want to talk about just about their particular view of the world. And then I've done it the other way around. We get stuck on a particular view of the world, and then we tell their story later. I feel like I've heard your story, but I want to know, because you have, I think, a unique perspective on this, so you can agree not to come back. It's fine.
Okay.
It's fine.
Okay.
But...
can we do a cliffhanger? Can it be like...
Yeah. Here's my question. My question is, you are married to a Palestinian Christian woman.
Yeah. Yeah.
There are an enormous amount of Palestinian Christians.
Yeah.
This might be something that a lot of people do not know, that the Palestinian that area has actually a lot of Christians there.
Yeah. Can I say something? Can I interrupt you real quick?
Yeah.
The majority of Christians in that area are Palestinian. Anyway, go ahead.
Yeah. And yet you've been involved in an evangelical faith in the United States that's been heavily influenced by a commitment to national political Israel.
Yeah.
And there are tensions, obviously, between Palestinians and Israelis that flare up in all sorts of times. So as an Arab man or having that, I just would love to hear your perspective on that. And I'm not in any way trying to put you in a position where you have to, this is something that a lot of Christian people in the US and other places are not actually not aware of how many of their Christian brothers and sisters are actually part of some of the people on the other side of a political fence from them in that part of the world, if that makes sense.
It makes perfect sense. The question that you're asking is actually really important to me. Mm. And a lot of the relationships that I have, I think part of, what I like to do, why I like food, when you sit and talk about food, we could talk about, there's a lot of ins, for having a conversation about culture and people and who we are as believers and politics, and it all ties into really faith.
Yep.
And I have so much to say about that. And I would love to have a conversation with you because, to the point that you made, I mean, we have to leave it one way. The thing that's hard is that there's believers suffering. We have to pray for our brothers and sisters across the planet.
Yeah.
When I think about, let's skip Israel, Palestine. When I think about North Korea, I mean, we don't like their leadership. We don't like what they believe in, but we love the people. And there are believers there. Mm-hmm. Same with China, Sian, and we could do this all day.
So many Chinese Christians.
Oh my, more, I mean, wow.
More than in the United States.
Wow. And you were talking earlier with Tommy about the progression of what church is going to look like.
Yeah.
It's going to look like China.
Yeah.
It's going to be like, hey, we better be really good at facilitating small group because church is going to be small group. We're going to get a little, WhatsApp notification. Jeff Bucknam's going to give us, an outline, and we're going to have to like preach at home.
Yep.
And we're going to have to memorize scripture because there might not be Bibles. And so the short of it is that what's unique about what's happening in Israel and Palestine and Jordan and Lebanon and Syria and part of Egypt is that it aligns with the story of how the world is going to end. And people should talk about it, and people should be empathetic to humans. And I'd love to talk about it. Is that good, a cliffhanger?
Yeah.
Is that, like, exciting?
Great cliffhanger.
All right, cool.
You should come back.
Yeah.
And we'll do it. Thank you so much for spending time talking to me.
You know, can we say stuff to you? We love what you do.
Oh, you're so nice.
I think it's great. And can I say something? You guys can cut it out. You can cut it out.
Yeah, we're going to cut out half of what
we you appreciate
said.
You in a way, because you've brought two cool things to church. You brought a tenderness and theology. And I love that.
I didn't think
you
were going to go there. I thought you were going to go with my dapper attire.
Yeah, we need
Whoa,
to talk.
Whoa, that was a little rough. That was a big like
I was
harumph.
Was it? I mean, look at me. I fought so hard against, I'm sorry. We appreciate
I thought it
you.
Was going to be,
You're a blessing.
Okay.
We love you. God uses you well.
Thanks, brother.
All right.
All right.
Is that it?
Catch next time.
All right, cool. Bye.